What's up, church family? Aren't you so glad to be here worshiping the Lord today? I tell you what, man, I was just so blessed listening to you worship and watching you worship. It's so good. Man, I'm Steve, and I feel so privileged to be here to share with you as part of the teaching team on weekends here at GV Christian. We're going to get into the Word here in just a few minutes, but before we do, I just want to take a minute to remind you of something that is extremely important to us as believers. It's this: no matter what chaos is happening in the world around us, as Jesus followers, we are motivated by his love, his guidance, and his wisdom. The Word tells us that we do not serve a God of chaos, but a God of peace in 1 Corinthians 13. See, so many people in this world that do not know him are motivated and driven and consumed by fear. We see all the doomsday coverage on the news, right? About the coronavirus, COVID-19. And the truth is, it's wise to be concerned, right? It's wise to be concerned about this sickness, just like it's wise to be concerned every flu season. And we deal with it by what we should be doing anyway: washing our hands regularly. Everybody? Staying home if you're not feeling well, right? But we do not allow ourselves to be consumed by fear and hysteria. We're challenged to be calm and not driven by fear. The Word tells us we are not given a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. We're told in Philippians chapter 4, don't worry about anything. Instead, pray. About everything. Tell God what you need and thank him for what he's already done. And when you do, the peace of God that is beyond all understanding will guard your hearts and mind in Christ Jesus. So before we do anything else, we're going to just pray this morning for God's healing touch, for his peace, for those working hard to come up with a vaccine to combat this virus, and then we're going to trust in Jesus because we're his, right? Amen? Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we come before you now, and in spite of the chaos that surrounds us, no matter what we face in this world, the cacophony of noise and fear, we stand in the confidence of knowing that we have a Savior, and that he is greater than all the things we might face in this world. You told us in your word that yours is the name above every other name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that he is Lord. So we ask now for your peace, Jesus, to guard our hearts and guard our minds, to take away all fear, because we are not given a spirit of fear. But let us be filled instead with your power, your love, and your soundness of mind, your clarity and focus moving forward. God, for those who are combating this virus, we ask that you would give them an anointing of your wisdom to do what they need to do. And for all of us, God, just let us be filled with your peace in all we do, everywhere we go. In Jesus' name, amen. So we're kicking off this brand new series called The Road. We're going to be taking a road together for the next several weeks from now until Easter, loosely following Jesus's journey through Luke. So if you want to look ahead at where we're going to go, you can start reading through the book of Luke and take a look at the path that Jesus took, some of the stops that he made along the way. If you would like to, you can sign up for our daily devotionals. Those are going to be starting next week. And it's basically just going to be like a little 2 to 3 minute video that you can do, very, very short amount of reading, but just a little snippet of God's word, just a little shot to get you through and to encourage you as we're going down this road together. So you can sign up for that at gvchristian.com. And those, like I said, are going to be kicking off next week. If you got your Bibles, though, let me see them. Hold them up in the air. Say word. We're going to be in the book of Hebrews to start off here in just a minute. Hebrews chapter 12. Then we're also going to be going, since we're going to be talking about Luke, Luke chapter 2 and Matthew chapter 2 is where we're going to be heading here in just a few minutes. So let me just start by asking you this. What are the odds, right? What are the odds? We live in an odds kind of town, don't we? Everything's all about the odds, right? People like make their livings betting on the odds, or they lose everything because the odds are not in their favor, right? It's all about the odds. So what are the odds? I thought it'd be fun to just kind of kick this weekend off by just throwing out some random little tidbits of trivia of the odds. For example, it's March, right? St. Patty's Day is coming. The odds of finding a four-leaf clover are about 1 in 10,000. About 1 in 10,000 clovers have the genetic marker that allows them to grow four leaves instead of three. That's kind of fun to know, right? Okay, let's keep going. About one out of every two of you will eat out every day this week. That blows my mind. About 1 in 20 will go to McDonald's. About 1 in 33, if you've had kids or plan on having kids one day, about 1 in 33 chance of having twins. About 1 in 100 chance of being ambidextrous and being able to use both hands equally. About a 1 in 6,000 chance of living to 100. Okay? Now, this is one that actually kind of broke my heart and made me sad. 32 million adults in the United States, 1 in 7 cannot read. Please know, I in no way am making a joke about that. And if you need help, man, that's what the church is here for. So come get help. It's March. Who's going to be following March Madness or creating your own March Madness bracket? Right? All the sporters, okay? The chances of filling out a perfect March Madness bracket, 1 in 128 billion. Did you know that Warren Buffett offers a prize for people that work for his company if they fill out a perfect March Madness bracket? He'll give them $1 million. That's crazy. Okay, next. Back in October 2018, remember the Mega Millions lottery broke all records, got to the highest lottery amount of all time at the same time. Didn't break records, but one of the highest of the Powerball, right? And so on that night, when those two different lotteries were drawn, for the Mega Millions, there was a 1 in 302 million chance of one person walking away with the total prize. For the Powerball, there was a 1 in 292 million chance of walking away with the $600 million prize. Now hold on, because you can win both. There's a chance, okay? The chances that night of walking away with the grand prize of both of those lottery prizes was 1 in 88 quadrillion. That is 88 with 15 zeros behind it. That's a lot of zeros. Chances of being struck by lightning on any given day is about 1 in 250 million. Hold on, though. On any given year, that reduces down to about 1 in 700,000. And over the course of your lifetime, about 1 in 3,000 chance of getting struck by lightning. So that should make you feel better about the next one. Anybody afraid of going in the ocean? There's a 1 in 3.7 million chance of being attacked by a shark. You got a better chance of being struck by lightning. Okay. About 1 in 6 chance of getting food poisoning this year. Yikes, right? Dirty dining, ew. About 1 in 2,500 will be hospitalized, and about 1 in 100,000 will die from food poisoning. Speaking of death, since we're in church and you want to be uplifted, right? You might think you have an equal chance of dying on any given day of the year, any of the 365 days of the year, right? But the odds say you are statistically more likely to die on your own birthday than any other day of the year. That's crazy, right? You have about a 1 in 5 million chance of dying in a plane crash. Anybody afraid of flying? You're pretty safe there. About a 1 in 500 chance of dying just walking down the street. About a 1 in 103 chance of dying in an automobile accident. So the lesson there is fly everywhere. Don't walk or drive. Another one that broke my heart, because it's an epidemic in our nation. 1 in 96 chance of dying from an opioid overdose. Listen, we have an incredible program here called Celebrate Recovery. We have counselors here. Get help. Get help, please. Because chances are somebody in this room is struggling. And the last one, about 1 in 10 read their Bible every day in the United States of America. So, what are the chances? Had you turned to Hebrews 12 a few minutes ago, we're going to be kicking off right there as we're jumping into this road that we're going to be on together. It says this in verse 1, therefore, since we're surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, remember every time it says therefore, you got to ask what it's there for. So in Hebrews 11, read that on your own this week. It's this whole amazing chapter that gives you the picture of the heroes of the faith, all those who have come before us and lived a life of faith and who God recognized for their faith. So therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses to the life of faith, let us throw off everything that hinders, the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and the perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinners, so you will not grow weary and lose heart. This road, we're on this road together, and Jesus went there first. And he says, fix your eyes on me, fix your eyes on Jesus, who is the author and the perfecter of our faith, the pioneer and the perfecter, the one who went before and is writing this story. He says, fix your eyes on me. I know it's gonna get hard. I know it's gonna get difficult. You're gonna go through storms and you're gonna go through fog and you're gonna go through rain and you're gonna go through all these things in life. But if you just fix your eyes on me because I'm walking in front of you, you will keep going on this road. It goes on to talk about hardships that we will face and enduring hardships as discipline and discipleship, allowing those things to hone you and sharpen you and make you better for the road ahead. And then finally in verse 12, the passage ends with this, therefore, take a new grip with your tired arms and stand firm on your shaky legs. Mark out a straight path for your feet so those who follow you may not stumble but become strong. We're all on a road. We're doing the best we can to follow Jesus as close as we can, but we also are leading others to him. Every one of us are somewhere on this journey together, walking down this road called life, and we're all at different stages of this road together. Jesus walked this road while he was here on earth. He journeyed from place to place, living life and changing lives while he was at it. Everywhere he went on this road, he left a lasting impact. Every place he set his feet, every place he stopped, every place he visited, he left that place changed forever, eternally impacted in such a way that we are still feeling the effects of the impact he made today. And now, when we align ourselves with him and choose to follow him and put our faith and trust in him, we walk the same road he walked. We may not stop the same places he stopped along the way, but our journey can follow his. And with him leading the way, we too can have a lasting impact every place we set our feet, every place we stop, every place we visit, and leave these places we are at changed forever. Even from the very beginning of his time on earth, the very moment of his arrival, Jesus left an impact. And this is where we're kicking off the road this weekend, the road part one, the road to Bethlehem. It's more than a Christmas carol. You know I want to sing it right now, don't you? Oh, little town of Bethlehem. Oh, how still we see thee lie. Oh, I'm not going to do it. I'm not going to do it. I'm going to hold off. I'm going to leave you. I'm going to leave you waiting. It says always leave them wanting more. Okay, so that's what I'm going to do. Bethlehem simply means the house of bread. Did you know that? That's what the name of the town means, the house of bread. Now you're like, I want Panera for lunch. I want to go to me to the house of bread and have some bread. Okay, bread is good. Unless you're doing keto, stay away from the bread. It's bad news. But because Jesus came to Bethlehem, the world will never be the same. Luke chapter 2, we're going to jump right into this story of Christmas and the story of Bethlehem and why Bethlehem and Jesus arriving in Bethlehem would leave the world changed forever. So let's just jump in. Luke 2, verse 1. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census to take place while Quirinus was governor of Syria. And everyone went to their own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and the line of David. He went to Bethlehem because that is where he was told to go by the governor. This is not the governor who's like, oh, your wife is pregnant. I want the baby to be born in Bethlehem because I want this to fulfill the prophecies of old. No. This was a total chance happening at this time in history, okay? Mary didn't say, Joseph, let's go to Bethlehem, okay? Mary was, she didn't want to take a 96-mile journey at 9 months pregnant, right? No. This was the Roman governor said, we need to take a census. I want everybody to go to their hometown for this census and register there. And they ended up in Bethlehem. Verse 5, he went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and expecting a child. While they were in Bethlehem, the time came for the baby to be born. She gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths, placed him in a manger because there was no guest room available for them. Matthew chapter 2, beginning verse 1. After Jesus was born in Bethlehem, in Judea, during the time of King Herod, Magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, where is the one who's been born the king of Judea? This is what I do for a living, right? Where is this one who has been born the king of the Jews? We saw his star when it rose, and we've come to worship him. When King Herod heard this, he was disturbed, all Jerusalem with him. When he had called together all the people's chief priests and the teachers of the law, he asked them where the Messiah was to be born. Hold on, verse 5. In Bethlehem, in Judea, they replied. Wait, hold on. Who did he call together? The chief priests, the teachers of the law, the scribes, those who knew the word of God inside and out. And he said, where was the Messiah supposed to be born? In Bethlehem, for this is what the prophet has written. But you, O Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah, for out of you will come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel. This is the prophecy quoted from Micah chapter 5, verse 2. Let's jump there real quick. Micah chapter 5, verse 2. But you, Bethlehem Ephrathah, though you are small among the clans of Judah, out of you will come for me one who will be ruler over Israel, whose origins are from of old, from ancient times. Verse 4. He will stand and shepherd his flock in the strength of the Lord, in the majesty of the name of the Lord his God, and they will live securely, for then his greatness will reach to the ends of the earth, and he will be our peace. All the way back. In fact, even those in Jesus' lifetime knew this. This was common knowledge among the people of Israel, among the Jewish family of God living in the land of Israel. John chapter 7, verse 40, Jesus is teaching a group of people, and on hearing his words, some of the people said, surely this man is a prophet. Others said, he is the Messiah. But still others asked, how can the Messiah come from Galilee? See, they didn't know where he was born. Because he was born in Bethlehem, but having been warned in a dream, Joseph took his family from Bethlehem to Egypt and hid them out until Herod died. And after he died, he took them back to where they were living in Nazareth, in Galilee. How could the Messiah come from Galilee, the people asked. Does not the scripture say the Messiah will come from David's descendants from Bethlehem, the town where David lived? Thus, the people were divided because of Jesus. Some wanted to seize him, but no one laid a hand on him. Does not the scripture say? The people knew it. They just didn't know where Jesus had actually come from, right? So we're going to talk about the road to Bethlehem, what the road to Bethlehem shows us. You ready? First, it shows us this. God had a plan. All the way back, God mapped out a grand plan. A plan of good news for all people, all nations, in all time, in all of history, from the beginning, to bring salvation to all people, through all time, through Jesus. Go all the way back to the beginning of the Bible. In Genesis, God is speaking to this guy, Abraham, who at that time, God hadn't even changed his name. He was still Abram, okay? And God is sitting there talking to him, and God gives him a promise. The Lord said to Abram in Genesis 12, verse 1, I will make you a great nation. I will bless you. I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. Verse 3, and all peoples on earth will be blessed through you. Genesis 18, verse 18, God reminds Abram of this promise. Abraham will surely become a great nation, a powerful nation. All nations on earth will be blessed through him. Genesis 22, 18, he reminds him again, and through your descendants, all the nations on earth will be blessed, all because you obeyed me. Then to his son in Genesis 26, he reminds him of that promise. I will cause your descendants to become as numerous as the stars in the sky. I will give them all these lands, and through your descendants, all the nations on earth will be blessed. See, God had a grand plan of salvation for all people for all time. He had a desire for them to live in the Garden of Eden for him, with him forever, to bask in his presence. But people messed up, right? Sinned. Lost that chance to be in the garden forever. Walked away from him and turned down his offer. And God knew that there was no way for people to come back to him, truly come back to him, unless he enacted a grand plan, bigger than what anyone in the whole wide world could begin to envision themselves, a plan that would span millennia, but would reach throughout time to bring salvation to all people. A plan not just to reach one nation, but to use one nation to reach everyone and create a massive multi-ethnic family, all committed to him. Next, the road to Bethlehem shows us God's plan was a promise. We just heard what people said. Does not scripture say, right? Herod turned to the teachers of the law, to those scribes, and he said, where was the Messiah to be born? They said, the prophet said, the prophecy, right? Anybody, when you hear the word prophet, prophecy, get like a funny picture in your head, right? Like Oogway from Kung Fu Panda. Like some kind of weird, funky dude with a staff who like is like, yes, let me tell you what the stars have spoken, right? Like we get this weird, like mystical, ethereal, kind of like floating, like weird understanding of, no. Listen, let me tell you this. Especially when it comes to biblical prophecy, a prophecy is just a fancy word for a promise. It's a promise of God, and God's plan was a promise. So we heard this promise that started all the way back with Abraham. Now listen, in Acts 3, it says this, verse 24. Starting with Samuel, every prophet spoke about what is happening today. In other words, what is happening right then with the followers of Jesus, with Jesus himself. Every prophet spoke about what is happening today. Verse 25, you are the children of those prophets. You are included in the covenant God promised to your ancestors. For God said to Abraham, through your descendants, all families on earth will be blessed. When God raised up his servant David, he sent him first to you people Israel to bless you by turning back each of you from your sinful ways. Galatians 3. Paul writes this, what's more, the scriptures, the prophecies looked forward to this time when God would make the Gentiles right in his sight because of their faith. Gentile, anybody in here Gentile? If you're not Jewish, you're a Gentile. You know that, right? God proclaimed this good news to Abraham long ago when he said, all nations will be blessed through you. So all who put their faith in Christ share the same blessing Abraham received because of his faith. God's plan was a promise. You know, in the Old Testament, scholars have determined there are hundreds of prophecies concerning the Messiah throughout the Old Testament. Hundreds. So next, the road to Bethlehem shows us God keeps his promises. Now, if you're taking notes this weekend, on your note sheet, here's what I want you to do. Right in front of that word keeps, I want you to put that little carrot thing. You know that little carrot thing, remember from English class? You want to insert something and make sure you understand something right there. Like put that little carrot thing in between God and keeps. And I want you to write in all caps, always. Because God always keeps his promises. And the proof was in the promises he made. Last year, Gary put out a verse for our church for the year, and the verse for our church for the year was Joshua 21:45. I was reminded of this as I was preparing this weekend. It says this, not one of all the Lord's good promises to Israel failed. Every one was fulfilled. Not one of the Lord's good promises to his people failed. Every single one was fulfilled. 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 20 reminds us, all of God's promises in Christ are yes. And through him, amen, is spoken by us, the glory of God. 2 Peter, though, reminds us, even though we know he always keeps his promises, do not forget one thing, dear friends, with the Lord, a day is like 1,000 years, 1,000 years are like a day. The Lord is not slow in keeping his promises, as some understand slowness. Instead, he is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. See, we exist here and now, and everything about us is here and now. We want everything that we want here and now, right? We have a hard time looking forward to the then and there, but God, his promises are always faithful. He always keeps his promises, but we want the promise here and now, right in front of me. And he says, don't you understand? I keep my promises, just not always the way that you want, in the time that you want. So he says, God is not slow in keeping his promises. Some understand slowness. So God made these promises, these prophecies throughout the Old Testament, right? But from the moment of the last one being written until the arrival of Jesus on the scene was a period of over 400 years of silence. No one even heard a word of the Lord during that time. So you imagine. You imagine putting your faith in silence and wondering, God, where's your promise? God, you said you were going to do this. What's happening? Why are you silent? Why haven't we heard from you? So let's go back and ask the question, what are the odds? What are the odds? In Mark chapter 10, Jesus gives us a little bit of teaching about odds. And funny enough, he's talking about money. A lot of his major points he made around money because he knew that money is a big deal when it comes to people, right? Mark chapter 10, verse 24, the disciples were amazed at his words, but Jesus said again, children, how hard it is to enter the kingdom of God. It's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of God. Why? Because they put their faith in their money. Verse 26, the disciples were even more amazed and said to each other, who then can be saved? Jesus looked at them and said, you ready for this? With man, this is impossible, but not with God. All things are possible with God. What are the odds? The promises, the prophecies, the road to Bethlehem, what are the odds? There's actually someone that figured this out. Did you know that? Let me tell you. Peter W. Stoner was a mathematics and astronomy professor. He sat down one day and gave 600 students a math probability problem to determine the odds for one person fulfilling 8 specific prophecies about the Messiah. He went on and expanded this research later. And let me just tell you the 8 prophecies that they started with. First, the Messiah would be born in Bethlehem. The Messiah would be born of a virgin. The Messiah would be from the lineage of King David. These are all from the Old Testament. A messenger would be sent to herald the Messiah. The Messiah would appear riding on a donkey. The Messiah would be betrayed for 30 pieces of silver. The Messiah would have his hands and feet pierced. People would cast lots for the Messiah's clothing at his death. So this group first began to calculate the odds of one person fulfilling all the conditions of one specific prophecy, right? So they took these specific prophecies, calculated the odds of each of these individual specific prophecies. Things like being betrayed by a friend for 30 pieces of silver. Things like being born in Bethlehem, which, by the way, did you know that Bethlehem is a small town? Like, at the time that Jesus would have been alive, there would have been less than 1,000 people living in Bethlehem. And so when we hear that Herod killed all of the boys 2 years old and under, we get this picture, right, of, oh my gosh, he killed hundreds of children. Realistically, he probably killed less than 20. Now, that doesn't make it any better, right? This is a small town, though. So what that means is, in the grand scope of all the people who've ever been born on earth, there's a very small fraction of people born in Bethlehem. Even today, the population is less than 30,000. That's a small town. So they took and they calculated the odds of all these different prophecies. And in his book, Science Speaks, Peter Stoner made the statement that the chances of just these 8 prophecies coming true by sheer chance in any one human being in all of history is 1 in 10 to the 17th power. That's 100 quadrillion. Now, remember what the chances of winning both the Megabucks and the Powerball were. 1 in 88 million, right? Or quadrillion, not million. 1 in 88 quadrillion, 8 with 15 zeros. This is 1 with 17 zeros. 100 quadrillion, right? That's a big number. It's like 100 quadrillion dollars. Yes, that's what I want. Okay, so here's what we need to understand. This is an astronomical number. This is massive. This is bigger than even we can begin to wrap our heads around. So just to give you a picture, I want you to picture the state of Texas. Anybody ever been to Texas? It's huge and flat. And it takes 98 days to drive through. If you've ever driven through the state of Texas, you're like, when's it ever gonna end, right? We did Florida, Georgia, Alabama, Louisiana in a day, and now we've been in Texas for 2 weeks. What's happening here, right? So here's Texas, right? Biggest state in the lower 48. I want you to imagine filling the state with 2 feet of silver dollars. That's a lot of silver dollars, right? That's a lot of square footage, a lot of square miles filled 2 feet deep with silver dollars. Take and put an X on one. Randomly place it somewhere out there. You could bury it. You could throw it. You could do whatever you want. Just somewhere in the middle of the state of Texas, put that silver dollar. Send a dude out blindfolded. Have him pick up one random silver dollar. Those are the chances. 1 in 100 quadrillion of finding the right one and having that happen. That's 8 prophecies. Let's add 8 more prophecies, total of 16. The odds jump astronomically more to 1 in 10 to the 45th power. That is 1 with 45 zeros behind it. This number is called a quaturodecillion. Never even heard of that before. Quaturodecillion, right? Using this same type of illustration, if we were to press this many silver balls into a pile, you ready for this? The pile would reach from the sun to Neptune in a 3-dimensional ball of silver dollars. put an X on one, randomly put it somewhere in that pile, and send a blindfolded dude out to find the one with one chance. Okay, hold on. You ready? Let's keep going. Back to what Peter Stoner was saying. Now using 48 of the prophecies made about the Messiah, these specific prophecies relating to time and place and events that would take place. 48 prophecies, the chance would be 1 in 10 to the 157th power. That is a 1 with 157 zeros behind it. Get rid of silver dollars because they're too big. This number, beyond any of our capability to comprehend, is large enough to fill the known universe with electrons many times over. Not silver dollars, individual electrons densely packed into a pile. Put an X on one, if you can. Send a blindfolded dude out to find it. And those are the chances of those 48 prophecies coming true by random chance in the life of one person in all of history. Peter Stoner states, to the extent then that we know this blindfolded man cannot pick out the marked electron, let alone the silver dollar, we know the Bible is inspired. This is not mere evidence. It is proof of the Bible's inspiration by God, proof so definitive that the universe itself is not large enough to hold the evidence. Peter Stoner made the comment that anyone who rejects Christ as the Son of God is rejecting a fact proved perhaps more absolutely than any other fact in the world. And the fact that Jesus had no control over things like where he would be born, when and how, where he would be buried, how he would die, just adds to the available evidence that he did not just work all his life to try to fulfill all these prophecies himself, so people would believe him to be the Messiah. So what are the odds? Well, from our perspective, beyond understanding, right? But here's what we need to understand. The odds from God's perspective, there was no doubt. There was a 100% chance that Jesus would fulfill every prophecy made and more. Because Jesus was the yes and amen to every promise that God made. These prophecies, these promises weren't spoken by God hoping that one day the one would come, right? They were spoken knowing that he would come and knowing who it would be. With God, there is a 100% chance of his will. There's a 100% chance that he's going to do what he says he's going to do. There's a 100% chance that God has and does and always will keep his promises. There are no odds to it. But these astronomical odds simply reveal that with God is the only way this could happen. There's no doubt from God that Jesus would fulfill every prophecy, odds aside. There's no doubt from God that he will keep every promise and prophecy he's given in our lives. So what are the odds? Jesus told us, with man it's impossible, but with God, all things are possible. So let's wrap this up. The road to Bethlehem shows us that God still has a plan, right? And you can trust it. He had a plan from the beginning. His plan was a promise. He always keeps his promises, and he still has a plan for you here and now today. You can trust the plan and the promise he has for you. I love the promise he made in Jeremiah 29:11 when he says, I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you, not to harm you, to give you a hope and a future. You are God's plan and God's promise here and now in this place. See, he made this plan, he made this promise, and he fulfilled it throughout history in the Old Testament, in the New Testament, and you are the continuation of the plan and the promise that he made. And here and now in this place, this is the road that we walk. And just the same way that Jesus affected every place that he went, that is what we are called to do. It doesn't matter what you do for a living, what you are paid for, what your vocation is. You are called to the ministry of the good news of Jesus Christ and to share his love, his mercy, his grace, and his peace to a world that is lost and in torment, a world that is full of fear and brokenness. This is the promise here and now. In us, through us, for us, to us. God still has a plan. And I'll bring it down to these last two things. First, he still seeks the lowly. The lost, the foolish, the looked down on. Going back to Luke chapter 2, tells us the story again of Jesus being born and the first people this was revealed to. It wasn't the scribes. It wasn't the teachers of the law. It wasn't the royalty and the kings of the day. It wasn't those who, by their words, could proclaim, "The Messiah is here," and watch what happened. The first ones it was revealed to were shepherds. Lowly, looked down upon, barely blue-collar shepherds living in the fields nearby. Nobody even wanted them in the city because they smelled like sheep. And sheep smell. And these guys were cast out, right? And in Luke 2, verse 8, it says, there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks by night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them. The glory of the Lord shone around them. They were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for I bring you the lowly, the lost, the broken, the foolish, the looked down upon. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all people. For today in the town of David, in Bethlehem, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord, and this will be a sign to you. You will find him wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." Like the shepherds, you may feel rejected, cast out, left aside, lowly, and destitute. But you are who he has chosen here and now to continue his great work in the world and to leave an impact everywhere you go today. 1 Corinthians 1, we're reminded of this. Brothers and sisters, think of what you were when you were called. Not many were wise by human standards. Not many were influential. Not many were of noble birth. But God chose the foolish things of the world to shame the wise. Sup, fools? God chose the weak things of the world to shame the strong. Sup, you weaklings? God chose the lowly things and the despised things and the things that are not to nullify the things that are so that no one may boast before him. And finally, he still seeks the lowly, the wise still seek him. Wisdom is not intellect. It's not education. Wisdom comes from who you choose to put your trust in. Throughout the Word of God, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Choosing a right relationship with God is what gives wisdom. And the wise still seek him. Going back into the story, again, Matthew chapter 2, these magi, they came from far in the east to seek him. Verse 7, then Herod called the Magi secretly, found out from them the exact time the star had appeared. He sent them to Bethlehem and said, "Go search carefully for the child. As soon as you find him, report to me so I too may go and worship him." After they heard the king, they went on their way. The star they had seen when it rose went ahead of them until it stopped over the place where the child was born. When they saw the star, they were overjoyed. On coming to the house, they saw the the child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down and worshiped him. They opened their treasures and presented him with gifts of gold and frankincense and myrrh. The Magi came from far away, from far in the east, following a single star, so that they could bow down and worship him, so that they could proclaim his goodness, so that they could bring their every gift to him and lay it at his feet. And now, here we stand with evidence enough to fill the universe many times over. Forget about one star. And the question is, will we seek him and all he has for us now? Going back to Jeremiah 29:11, I want to remind you. He says, I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you, not to harm you, to give you hope and a future. Goes on from there. Then you will call on me. Pray to me. I will listen to you. You will seek me, and you will find me. When you seek me with all your heart, I will be found by you, declares the Lord. So let's wrap up with this. Matthew chapter 6. Jesus is teaching about worry. Jesus is teaching about fear. So many people in this world, in this time, are consumed by fear. And in Matthew 6:33, he's telling us, don't allow yourself to be consumed with worry about all these things that everybody else worries about. But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these other things will be given to you as well. Therefore, don't worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. Let's pray. As we wrap up in prayer, I'm just going to say a quick prayer together. But I want to challenge you, as you are praying with God, be specific. Ask boldly. Don't fear praying or asking specifically for what you need. Ask, seek, and knock like your God is capable of overcoming tremendous odds with 100% accuracy and 100% assurance. So there was no doubt from God that Jesus would fulfill every promise and every prophecy, odds aside. And there's no doubt from God that he will keep every promise and prophecy he's given in our lives now. So Jesus, we come before you now. And I thank you for every man and woman within the sound of my voice who is hearing your word, your good news, your promises. And God, looking all the way back to beginning, we know that you had a plan. From the beginning, your plan was a promise. We trust that you always keep your promises. And God, we know that you still have a plan for us. So help each of us individually to begin to discover and determine what your plan is in our lives today, to see how we can make an impact right where we are, just like you did. God, you still seek the lowly. Thank you for seeking the lowly. For seeking us even when we walk away from you. For seeking us even when we turn our backs on you. For seeking us even when we are in the depths of the darkness, in the pit of despair. And so, God, today we choose to seek you. We say that, say today, God.
Today, God.
I choose to seek you.
I choose to seek you.
You promised that I would find you. We pray all these things in Jesus' name.
Thank you.
Amen.